Remember him? Uri Geller, the man who once amazed David Dimbleby and us all with this fork.
I'm holding it very, very gently. And I'm giving it a little...
It's bending.
It's bending very, very gently.
Today, 10 years on, he's still at it.
Yeah. Come here, look. Melt. I want you to touch it here and see. It's beginning to become...
And there's a new generation of metal benders from all corners of the globe. They say it's a form of the paranormal, psychokinesis, moving metal with your mind.
If any person can make the metal samples inside these sealed tubes bend by psychokinetic powers, I'll give them $10,000.
Visualize this powerful light going into the metal and get ready, ready, bend! Bend!
Bend!
But this housewife from Birmingham is one of hundreds today discovering the Geller touch.
It's like it's becoming like plastic. Yeah, it's breaking.
It's breaking. There's a crack.
It's very.
When Uri broke that first fork in 73, he really started something. Cutlery bent in people's homes whenever he appeared. And lots of children said they could do it too. Scientific professors like John Taylor started a massive investigation. Enter James Randi, a conjurer who's made a career saying it's all trickery.
But look at this. It seems to be bending. It seems to be getting liquid. Look at this. If I hold it like that, you can actually see it trembling. It appears to get liquid. Look at that. A simple conjuring trick that children all over Britain and all over the world learned to do after seeing Mr. Geller do it on television.
In America, Uri Geller performed before the scientists. But at Stanford, despite hours of tests, they remained unconvinced. Meanwhile, in Britain, experimenters spied on the children. They deliberately turned their backs, and a hidden camera caught some of them in the act using plain brute force. Subtle cheats, others more obvious. In properly controlled experiments, there wasn't a bend in sight. Professor John Taylor, once a firm believer, now says it's probably all hooey. Professor John Hasted is a top physicist at London University, and he still firmly believes. He says he's got the evidence to show children can do bends that can't be explained away by cheating.
Many of these doubtful happenings may have been that people didn't know their own strength, that they were quite unconsciously cheating, not deliberately. But even with these children, we found numbers of stroking bends which impressed us. You take the bending of the bowl, which was done with the thumbs like this by a girl, and that was sufficient to impress me.
The metal, it's said, softens and then bends or breaks. One of his star benders was Stephen North.
Well, it was when I was 10 and Uri Geller had first come over to this country. It was the David Dimbleby program he was on, and I was watching it, and while I was watching, I was eating a bowl of cereal, and suddenly the spoon I was eating with suddenly bent and broke in half. Since then, I've found that I'm able to bend fairly thick bars of metal. I've also been able to bend pieces of metal without touching them.
Thanks for the last 7 years, Professor Hasted has been asking, is it true? And if so, what's the metal bender's power? He puts his benders in a special, electrically shielded cage designed to keep out all stray signals. No touching is allowed, and so the effect may be diminished, but these strain gauges will register the slightest twitch of the metal. Much of the time, nothing happens, but occasionally, Stephen seems to get signals to occur. The metal appears to flex in short bursts, lasting about a second.
I think he's making dislocations within the metal caused by atoms moving. It's very difficult to find out how some information, I don't like to call it a force, but some information should get from Stephen's brain to these particular atoms. This might be an interaction between mind and matter.
At an even smaller scale, Hasted's confirmed benders can affect individual atoms buried inside metal. Special radioactively marked atoms seem to move their position under the metal bender's hands. But Hasted knows he's got a job convincing anyone.
We've only, I think, 4 cases of success. We've got to build up these cases, and I think eventually, if we have enough experiments of that sort, then that will be some of the very best evidence.
Support for Hasted has come from France. Metallurgists who make the alloys for Concorde have laboratory tested France's answer to Uri Geller, Jean-Pierre Girard. Dr. Charles Croussard, the firm's chief director of research, ran the experiments and supplied the metal samples. The tests on Girard were done over a 3-year period. It's probably the most extensive metal bending research, but James Randi says the scientists were being fooled by a simple trick.
Watch it carefully and you will see the bend slowly begin to develop. This is a piece of aluminum of some kind.
The bar is already bent, and the trick is to imperceptibly rotate it in the fingers, bringing the bend more into view.
And what you have just seen is exactly the technique that is used by Jean-Pierre Girard to produce apparently paranormal bends in a piece of metal.
But Girard can't be dismissed that easily. He was tested by 2 French magicians who could detect no trickery, and the metallurgists say he bent bars in controlled conditions beyond human strength. They also say, explain this. Like John Hasted in England, the scientists wanted to know if Girard could affect a piece of metal without actually touching it. They were, of course, experts in metallic analysis. This machine tests the hardness of metal very accurately with the point of a diamond. The harder the metal, the less the diamond sinks in. Girard told the scientists he felt he'd affected a 20 millimeter area in the center of the plate. And indeed, right in the middle, the metal was 10% harder. And they gave Girard bars sealed in tubes. The bars came out bent. To the Girard research, the skeptics have no really good answers, except to say, do it again for us.
The challenge that I've had going for 18 years now, going on 19 years, is very simple. To any psychic who can produce evidence of any paranormal event of any kind under proper observing conditions, I will award $10,000.
Girard took up the challenge. He'd bent before others, but in front of Randi, he failed. And crucially, in a tube supplied by Randi, he couldn't bend the metal. Randy's happy to continue to put his money where his mouth is.
$10,000 if they can successfully deform the metal. That's all. It's a very simple test.
A rare glimpse of Silvio Meyer, the Uri Geller of Switzerland. He's ignored Randy, but local magicians say he's genuine, and the world's hardest currency, the Swiss franc, goes all soft in his hands. He's also had scientific tests. Top right is a spoon and Silvio's hand. Now watch. Impressive stuff, but wait. This was his own recording, and no one was there at the time.
We tried to make him work before a professional camera, but this did not work. You know that. Parapsychology is an invasive science. And so we installed in his apartment in Bern a video equipment, gave him spoons, forks, and so on, controlled objects, in glass tubes sealed, and instructed him to experiment before the camera. And so we got quite a lot of very good material.
Es muss gehen. Wahnsinnig, wahnsinnig nervös und aufgeregt.
But skeptics like Randi say that without proper witnessing, this is meaningless evidence.
You can always say there may be some hidden tricks and so on. I know there are no tricks, and this is sufficient for me. It's not my job to convince professional skeptics.
This man's on the professor's side. He's doing Britain's first metal-bending PhD, Julian Isaacs.
Many people think that I must be completely mad to do research into paranormal metal bending, but I think that the evidence already does exist which ought to convince any fair-minded person that the effects are genuine.
So why is it so difficult to prove?
The psychology of these forms of paranormal skill is such that if somebody tries to produce the effect, and if they're also subject to hostile forms of witnessing, then they tend not to produce the effect. They tend to get inhibited.
Close your eyes and just feel what the fork or the spoon feels like. And I want you to come with me into a little imaginary visual picture. Start off.
This is a Julian Isaacs metal bending screening session near Birmingham.
From the top of your head through your arms into the metal. Feel the metal actually responding.
He's convinced many of us might be Uri Geller's.
Making the metal turn soft and bending. And then I want you all together to shout, bend, bend, bend.
I would expect in the ordinary population, something like 1% of the average population ought to be able to do metal bending.
Come on, again, we want again. The rest of you doing it as well. Come on. Support me, all come together. Ready? Bend! 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 Carry on, go on, bend. Make it bend, go on, get it going, bend.
Isaacs says he's so far discovered 100 metal benders, among them some pretty level-headed people.
Quite suddenly, I felt that my thumbs were pressed together, and when I looked down, I found that the fork that I'd been holding was bent round my thumbs, with no explanation that I could put to it at all.
Suddenly, I'm holding a piece of cutlery that had doubled, bent in two. It had turned into sort of a soft jelly-like substance, and I was quite amazed, actually.
Yeah, it's like chewing gum is starting to set. Just as you rub it, it just starts to curl up.
And again, bend, come on.
But hey, that doesn't look an awfully paranormal bend.
That's right, that's good. I can see one going. Well done. That's jolly good.
Could it all be a big con? Isaacs says no.
Come on.
Back in the psychology lab, Isaacs checks out and trains his most promising subjects on this test rig. At its heart is a sensitive piezoelectric crystal, which he claims will detect the slightest metal bending movement and nothing else. It's classical biofeedback. The bender hears the crystal move and so learns to improve. Isaacs hopes to train his star performers out of those tiresome inhibitions.
We're really in a completely different ball game from the days when we thought that metal benders were exceptional and rare people. They're not. There are lots of metal benders all over the place.
Madison, Wisconsin, USA, where we went to an international gathering in search of the elusive bend.
Ladies and gentlemen, this afternoon we have three young metal benders. These are individuals who can bend metal using their minds. So let's have a warm round of applause for Masuaki Kiyota, Steve Shaw, and Mike Edwards.
Japan's chief bender had jetted in from Tokyo, and there were a couple of top US ones. But the biggest crowd came for the great man himself, Uri Geller.
Somebody gave me this to bend. I don't know. By the way, it's yours? You eat with this? Or?
Now married and living in New York, right. Uri does just a few stage shows a year and no more science.
I gave myself so much time in the last 10 years to science.
And yet science doesn't...
No, the hard scientific community, Tony, around the world, especially in America, does not believe in psychic phenomena. They think it's all magic, it's trickery. Many scientists say, you know what, you bend metal or you fix broken watches, but we can't explain it, therefore it doesn't exist. That's nonsense, it's not true. And also, it's hard, especially to prove it in a laboratory. Very difficult. For some reason, the phenomena doesn't want to occur in a laboratory. Or when a person is put under a camera is rolling, I have to perform, it doesn't happen.
But later that day, for our camera, it did.
I'm beginning to stroke it on the thin part, and I purposely took a bigger spoon, on the very thin part of the spoon, and I'm wishing it to bend. And again, these are your spoons. I'm saying bend, melt, and break. What I'm doing with this spoon, if it works, it should, because I picked up energy, I feel good from you. Look. It's becoming waxy. Yes, look. It's becoming like plasticine.
10 years after Dimbleby, it's the same line.
It becomes really loose. And again, this was a spoon. I'm showing it to you, look. Now look. Don't clap hands. I'm putting the brake to his hand. It's cold. There's absolutely no heat. What happens is, by stroking it, some energy, this psychokinetic energy, melts the molecular structure of the metal and breaks it.
But little did we or Geller know, the bender's arch enemy was right there in the audience.
Now, I was not allowed to attend this convention, so I went in disguise. If you look very carefully into the front row, right here, there's a gentleman taking a picture. His name is Adam Gerson. And Adam Gerson actually is an anagram for James Randi. I was wearing a dark wig, and I dyed my beard dark reddish brown, wore black contact lenses, false teeth, and a bit of a pot belly. It's a rather frightening figure. I look more like the Wolfman, but it fooled Uri Geller.
Predictably, he says Geller cheated.
Preparing a spoon for the Geller spoon bending trick is not at all difficult, but it takes some time. You must take a spoon and fatigue fracture it by bending it back and forth several hundred times. I'd like to show you one which has already been prepared and planted in among the regular spoons. It doesn't look any different from an ordinary spoon. As a matter of fact, it can be pounded, dropped, it sounds and rings exactly like a regular spoon. And unless you examine it microscopically closely, right at the neck here, you wouldn't find any mark that would give it away. But handled between the hands like this, it seems to get rubbery. Look at this.
We put the charge together. Does he cheat?
No way, ever. Why should I? I mean, why?
We needed independent evidence, so we took the spoon that Uri had broken to the metallurgy department of Leeds University. Professor Jack Nutting there is an expert on fractures in steel. He first wanted to look at the fracture in cross-section. That sideways slice through the handle went under the microscope. Natting got a good side view of the fracture and saw that the top and bottom surfaces had some interesting telltale cracks. Then the bowl end. Into this high-powered electron microscope went the other side of the fracture. They looked at it face on. Geller claimed he'd melted the molecular structure, but the spoon showed the signs of having been fractured rather differently.
In my opinion, what had happened was that the spoon had first been bent in that direction, like that. Then it had been bent back, like that. And then it had been waggled about, like that. Now, we can deduce this from the micrograph here.
To the expert, these were the telltale signs. That top ridge looked like an initial big bend, and the fine lines below repeated waggling that would weaken the spoon and lead to the final break there.
The form of this fracture is really what metallurgists would call a high strain fatigue fracture. It is perfectly normal, shows no abnormalities, and certainly no paranormal forms of failure.
The Marquess of Bath has also seen another Geller bend.
Yes, it's happening. It's happening.
On some of his lordship's own personal silver.
Yes, it's bent. Look, it's becoming there.
This was no stage show, but a private session in 1976 at Longleat, and there were many witnesses, and none saw any trickery.
There's no heat at all. Touch it. There's absolutely no heat.
Is that solid silver, Lord Bath?
Yeah, okay. It was made by Gerard's in London.
So might this spoon show any metallurgical abnormalities? Fortunately, at Longleat, they'd kept the spoon as a prize souvenir, and so we asked if we could borrow it for analysis. The silver hallmarks showed up clearly, but we wanted to get a look at that all-important fracture surface. And what did it show? Again, the same type of ridges that the experts associate with high-strain metal fatigue, caused by bending the spoon back and forth. So does Geller do it all by trickery? Well, our metallurgical evidence can't answer that conclusively, one way or the other. But we can say that the two spoons that we examined showed none of Geller's melted molecules. In fact, nothing abnormal at all.
Is that solid silver, Lord Bath?
Meanwhile, back in Wisconsin, were our three junior benders, 21-year-old Steve Shaw.
I seen Uri Geller on TV, and he was bending a spoon at the time. And at first I thought, well, if he can do it, I can do it. Picked up a spoon, broke it into pieces. And I was scared. But time went on, and I realized, no, I'm not some kind of freak. Everybody can do what I do.
Mike Edwards.
I think it does come somewhere from the subconscious. Visualize an intense white light, and I can feel this energy just begin to build up. And if something is going to go, there is a sudden release of energy when the thing starts bending.
And the 18-year-old Japanese, Masuaki Kiyota. He had been bending metal way before Geller, when he was 5. His twists are famous because he appears to make them with just slight finger pressure. But look, there's Mr. Randi again in his Wolfman outfit.
I note that Masuaki is very fond of heavy belt buckles. He wears a huge brass belt buckle about so big, and it's more than a quarter of an inch thick in solid brass. It has slots cut in it to spell a word, and what he has done, in my opinion, is simply to take the spoon, stick it into one of those slots, and give a twist.
That's only his theory. Randi never saw the boy do it.
Well, I don't know how many people know about James Randi. He is of the impression that everybody in the world knows about him.
He, of course, has been on numerous television programs, making the claim that this is all trickery. He will take a spoon and he'll bend it back and forth 200 times and shake it, and then claims that that's the way it's all done. I've seen so many cases where a spoon or other metal was bent by very gentle stroking, and in some cases without being touched, that you've got to admit that there's something paranormal happening.
Dr. Uphoff, the organizer of that metal bending convention, invited us and three other film teams to a private view. We were all trying to record that elusive bend. There was bending aplenty, but no one could capture it actually happening. On the other hand, no one filmed or saw any trickery. Yet more bends. Something clearly was happening, but it was inconclusive, so we invited the three benders to take part in a full-scale trial of our own.
These are two spoons that have come from a household here in Madison, Wisconsin.
The place, the TV studio of the local university. As witnesses, a conjurer, two metallurgists, and three simultaneously recording TV cameras, conditions the benders were happy to accept. To help create the right atmosphere, there was an audience of friends and well-wishers. Nevertheless, everything was 100% controlled.
At no time shall there be any noticeable leverage exerted, that is to say, a firm grip on the bowl of the spoon, and leverage here would invalidate the experiment. Yeah. Are we ready? Thanks.
Thank you.
After nearly an hour, Steve Shaw gave up. Mike Edwards thought music would help.
It's so ghastly.
I can stroke this.
This is classical music.
The music didn't. They took it in hour-long turns. The Japanese Mazuaki. We watched him for over 2 hours. After 6 hours recording, nothing. Which was surprising because the two American benders had been apparently satisfactorily performing for years in front of a team of American scientists at the McDonnell Laboratory. Its deputy director, Dr. Mark Schaefer.
At Washington University in St. Louis, we have been working, first of all, to establish the range of abilities that Mike and Steve have, because these have apparently included being able to move small solid objects across a tabletop, influencing a variety of metal objects such as keys and silverware and metal bars and metal rods, sometimes touching and sometimes at a distance, and also influencing photographic film.
So why didn't anything happen for us? Well, the answer came when Mike and Steve were the star guests at a press conference. It was held in New York last month and was a major TV news story there. The man who called in the press was none other than our old friend, James Randi.
I'm going to ask these two gentlemen a very simple, direct question. Can you tell us, how do you do it?
Although, be quite honest, we cheat.
Edwards and Shaw weren't metal benders after all. They were magicians. But for 4 years, they had made the scientific team believe they were genuine. A hoax, masterminded by you-know-who.
we did everything we possibly could to warn these people they were being flim-flammed. The kids themselves, the two subjects, were instructed specifically, if they were ever asked, is that a trick, or are you doing tricks, are you magicians, or anything like that, they were to immediately say, yes, it is a trick, and we were sent here by James Randi to test your ability to detect trickery.
Randi says he's just trying to prove the scientists are gullible. The laboratory are now denying they were fooled, but sad for him, Dr. Schaefer must live by what he said to us before Randi's revelations.
I don't believe they're tricking us, especially based on the research that we've done in the last year, where we have exerted as tight a control condition as we could think of, even in consultation with magicians, to see if the influence holds up. And we have found evidence that it does. Not as strongly under these control conditions. It's as if somehow the extra controls seem to inhibit it, but still an effect persists.
What with planted fake benders, gullible scientists, and wolfman disguises around, the truth hasn't got much chance. Indeed, back last summer, we had asked Randi quite specifically whether Mike and Steve were plants. His answer then sounded like a denial.
It's absolutely not true. I have certain ethics in this business. I would never, with a scientist, get together to try to deceive somebody or embarrass somebody.
The only kind Clearly, of thing I would ever in the metal bending business, the truth isn't easy to come by. But wait, what about those $10,000 tubes? They were designed to be completely fraud-proof, and top British bender Stephen North was keen to try one.
Do you think you'll be able to do something with that?
Well, I don't know. I've bent things in sealed containers before, so I'd certainly like to have a go at it and see.
Good luck.
Well, thanks a lot.
But when he returned the tube, the bar was still straight. We gave tubes to four other top benders, and not one came back bent. Metal bending's not proven. But last autumn in Cambridge, at a worldwide gathering of parapsychologists, it was a hot conversational topic.
And this one began bending upwards like that.
It's a tantalizing, frustrating phenomenon. It will neither let itself be definitively proved nor completely go away.
Amazing.
I was in South Africa last week. I took three children. I gave them all spoons. I'd never done this before. I said, kids, it's natural. Anyone can do it. I said, kids, oh. Two of the spoons went like that.
So, General, did you come here?
And in fashionable Washington, behind closed doors, this is the latest craze, metal bending parties. With people bending for fun, how long will that $10,000 be safe?